Thank you very much for nice introduction, and thank Dina for particularly for the invitation and all the work. It is a really great pleasure to present my work in this webinar. So today, I'd like to show the structural complexity and local heterogeneity of nanocrystals observed by coherent X-ray diffraction imaging. I may want to use the laser pointer. Okay. Can you see the laser pointer?
Yes, we can.
Okay, good. Actually, before I go into the main topics of my talk, I'd like to take an opportunity to introduce the synchrotrons and on XFR in Korea briefly, since it is not well known to all the Europeans particularly. So currently, we have a third generation synchrotron, PLS2, upgraded in 2011 to 3GB machine and XFR, which is PAL XFR, started user operation in 2017. In PAL XFR, two hard X-ray beamlines stations, which are X-ray scattering and spectroscopy and nanocrystallography and imaging, and one soft X-ray beamline for soft X-ray scattering and spectroscopy. The detailed descriptions is shown here, and the inside of the hard X-ray stations are shown here. The experimental area at XSS station is also shown here for your information. And the third generation synchrotron PLS2 has 36 beamlines, and one particular beamline, 9C, is dedicated to the coherent X-ray scattering. And we will have a new fourth generation synchrotron, which is located at Ochang, which is in the middle of South Korea, and which is actually the plan. The construction is started officially last year. So now technical design is in progress, and we hope that we can do more work related to the coherence. And among the 10 first beamlines planned, two of them are dedicated to the coherent applications. So now I will start the main subject. And last decade, there are tremendous efforts to make nanoparticles for various applications. So the by techniques based on electrons, for example, mainly by scanning electron microscopy and transmission electron microscopy is dedicated to characterize the structures. In this case, the shape of nanocrystals and with atomic resolution of the structures were available to determine. However, it is still difficult to get the local heterogeneity in an entire nanocrystal, which the size with, for example, 100 nanometers, even by TEM. And it is still not convenient to measure in situ and or operando conditions. Therefore, in my talk, I'd like to show a few examples of local heterogeneity of the nanocrystals observed by coherent X-ray diffraction imaging technique. So I guess that there are already introduced and discussed about the coherent X-ray diffraction imaging technique. So I may not need to introduce in detail about the coherent X-ray diffraction imaging technique in this webinar series. But just I like to briefly mentioning about how it works about the coherent X-ray diffraction imaging at break geometry. So when the coherent X-ray are exposed at a crystal sample, one can observe break peak at the center and fringes along the crystal shape or crystal orientation. But with this pattern, we cannot get the imaging result because we measure the intensity So which means we lost the phase information. However, starting with this the phase retrieval algorithm, which is known well to us. So starting with a random phase and the proper set of iterations in phase retrieval process, we can get the image of the shape and phases, which can be converted to atomic displacement of the entire sample. So three-dimensional image can be obtained by from the coherent X-ray diffraction pattern with the Rocking Curve scan in the next slide. So here it shows. Oh, sorry. No. Which we can see the three-dimensional diffraction pattern by rotation of the samples, and we can get the three-dimensional image by reconstruction process. So by having done that, we can really get the shape of the crystals in three dimensions. So now, using this coherent X-ray diffraction imaging is achievable at nanoscale with picometer sensitivity to the crystalline lattice distortions, which is shown here. So which means actually spatial resolution of this technique is still few tens of nanometers, or best thing is like 10 or 5 nanometers. But the sensitivity of the lattice changes can be less than atomic resolution, sub-angstrom, which means the picometer level distortions can be detected. Also, as you can see, the in situ measurement or measurement depending on the synthetic conditions are easily available. So the experimental results shown in my talk are carried out at the following beamlines, 30 IDC at advanced photon source, and P10 at Petra 3 in Deji, and 9C at PLS 2 in Korea, and XCS station in LCLS in US. So as an example of local heterogeneity, I like to show what we found with GSM-5 geolite microcrystals first. So in GSM-5 microcrystal is nanoporous silicate, which is synthesized with such organic base with material sources. So by employing BRAC-CDI technique, it was successfully obtained the shape of the crystal and internal distribution of the displacement and strain, shown here. So the surprise comes from the measurement with the temperature dependence shown in the on the right side. So actually at 200 Celsius, diffraction pattern shows distorted, which is unexpected because the since crystal or orientation of the crystal or the shape of the crystal should not change at 200 Celsius. So the reason for this strain structure is mainly due to inner part with very minute the organic residue having opposite thermal expansion behavior, which means basically the GSM-5 crystals shows the negative thermal expansion up to 200 Celsius. And above that, actually, positive thermal expansion behavior. But with the synthetic process, inner part has a very minute magnitude of organic residue still there. And this with a small amount of organics, the inside of the crystal shows opposite thermal expansion behavior, which means the core part shows the positive thermal expansion behavior, but the outside shell part shows the negative expansion, thermal expansion, which causes really the unexpected distortion in the diffraction pattern, as well as the result comes to the imaging result. This small, very minute magnitude of the organic residue was confirmed by confocal fluorescence microscopy. So, which means this is a heterogeneity of the nanocrystal originated from the synthetic process of the zeolite crystals. Then, the next one is the another example of heterogeneity of the zeolite crystal. But in this case, we measured copper ion exchanged GSM5 zeolite crystals during the deoxygenation of nitrogen oxide with propene, which is a crucial catalytic process in vehicle exhaust. So in this case, same type of the GSM5, but we actually exchanged copper ion, and actually the actual location of the copper is near aluminum site. So in this particular experiment, we used in situ time resolved coherent X-ray diffraction imaging conducted at LCLS, XCS station at LCLS. So to observe structural responses with different reactants, our study was conducted in two stages, one for propene adsorption here, and the second step was actually NOx deoxygenation by inserting NO and oxygen in the presence of adsorbed propenes. So in this case, what we observed was during the propene adsorption are shown on the left, and then the second step of the nitrogen oxide deoxygenation process are shown on the right-hand side. So at a selected time when distinct changes are observed are shown here. So as you can see, really with the increasing time, increasing exposure time of the propene, the distorted diffraction pattern observed. And then when NO, nitric oxide, and oxygen entered, even severely distorted diffraction pattern observed, and then end of the reaction process finishes, actually the diffraction pattern becomes to the initial stage almost. So in this case, actually after the propene adsorption finishes, we removed the leftover propene, so which means actually NO and O2 with the adsorbed propene reaction finishes, the crystal becomes the normal. Okay, so the next row shows the imaging result, and again we can observe really distorted or heterogeneity of the crystals are observed. And interestingly, the lattice constant, actually in this case, the change of the lattice constant with respect to the lattice, which we defined as strain rate coefficient changes opposite direction. So when the propene adsorbed, the lattice strain rate coefficient shows negative direction, but the during the nitric oxide deoxygenation process, the strain rate coefficient actually becomes positive. So it is clear the interaction between the copper ions and introduced gas molecules are reflected in the all average variations in the lattice spacing. So to find the origin of the unusual strain development during the adsorption and catalytic processes related to the heterogeneity, we take an X-ray fluorescence microscopy at hard X-ray nanoprobe station at NSLS2. So this is the image of the copper exchanged GSM5. The result shows actually inhomogeneous distribution of copper forming ring-like regions. Actually, this inhomogeneous distribution of copper is related to inhomogeneous aluminum distribution of the crystals. So with this inhomogeneous distribution, we can get the model with this propene adsorption. And actually, using the finite element analysis, we can model them and compare with the experimental result, which means actually our data shows, our result shows the adsorption state of the propene as a model, this model, and finite element analysis result and experimental data during the propene adsorption at different times are consistent with our experimental result. And even though the result at 250.5 second and 251 second, which is just 0.5 second difference, but still our experimental result shows very good agreement with the simulation result, which means actually using the XFL short pulse, we can really see the changes with the 0.5 second time resolution. So this result mainly is related to the heterogeneity related to the inhomogeneous kappa distribution. To confirm that result, we calculated the origin of effect of the reactants on the lattice using density functional theory. The most stable positions of the molecules are compared with the ones located at different poles and compared with those molecules located to the close to the active sites in the same pole here. So our result shows the actually that we confirmed the heterogeneity by modeling using the finite element analysis with stress tensors. So we conclude in addition to the inhomogeneous distribution of the copper ion in GSM5, the coexistence of nitric oxide and oxygen molecules located near the propene and copper active sites in the same pore is critical to the generation of unusual strain distribution during this nitric oxide deoxygenation process. Another case, actually in this case, we investigated the internal deformation of the same kappa exchanged geolite crystal during the adsorption of four different hydrocarbons. Depending on alkyl chain length and existence of the double bond in the molecule or linear structure versus Bunsen ring structure, etc., with the temperature and duration of time. So here is just a brief summary of with the temperature. And as you can see, propene and propane are compared with the existence of double bond in three carbon molecular structure, and n-hexane and benzene are either linear or ring structures in the six carbon system. So their chemical properties and relative molecular size to the pore channels allow different effects of the adsorption interactions on the kappa ion, kappa 2 plus sites, which result in various strands of the internal strain distribution of the zeolite crystal. So in this case, heterogeneity of the GSM5 due to same inhomogeneous distribution of kappa ion in the zeolite is found. Some more details about the result I'm showing here. So in each molecule system, temperature-dependent strain field evolution is observed here. So, okay. So the coherent X-ray diffraction patterns and retrieved images consistent with the FEA, finite element analysis simulation result show how the internal structures, including lattice deformation of the crystal, can be varied with different molecules. So the comparison of the experimental results here and then calculation or simulation by finite element analysis during the propene shown in the left and during the propane adsorption are shown on the right. So actually, each panel includes the experimental data and retrieved coherent X-ray diffraction pattern are compared, and displacement field from the experiment and displacement from the simulation are compared. Actually, this simulation result is from the model on the right-hand side. So actually, this was a two-dimensional result, so which we cannot get all three-dimensional images. So we basically summed in the depth direction, but interestingly, it is very consistent with our experimental result. So the message here is when kappa GSM5 crystals were exposed in three carbon systems, even at room temperature, more fringes were observed in the CXD the patterns here. And 100 Celsius, for example, already in the center of a peak was changed and dramatic variations in the diffraction pattern were revealed at 150 Celsius and higher. So deformation of the displacement obtained from the retrieval process was released up to 100 Celsius, showing relatively weak chemical interactions of the GSM of the kappa 2 plus sites. And over 150 Celsius, the strong deformation from the top side edges connected to the bottom was observed, meaning that the molecules adsorb at the kappa ions from the outer shell and to the center part of the crystal with increasing temperature. So this result show very good agreement with the experimental I mean, the FEA model. And in comparing two systems, propene showed a relatively more dramatic evolution in the lattice deformations than the propane adsorption at lower temperature. So, which means actually the heterogeneity comes from the inhomogeneous distribution of kappa as well as the like a chain length and the double bond existence affecting to the strain development. Similarly, in the 6-carbon systems, both benzene and n-hexane, the CXT patterns shows variation of the center peak at 100 Celsius here. So actually, the center peak shape is actually changed. And the strong strains at the upper side were evolved at the bottom with the increasing temperatures up to 150 Celsius. So the strong deformation suggests that n-hexane and benzene adsorb at the kappa side, kappa ions at both the outer shell and the center part at the same temperature, reflected in the FEA model too. So more active variation in the internal structure have occurred in the benzene adsorption, as you can see here. So overall, 4-carb hydrocarbons allowed noticeably different internal deformations in the kappa GSM5 crystal. However, we found that when the diffusion occurred in the center ring here, the shape of the central break peak in the coherent X-ray diffraction patterns was changed to triangular, mainly due to the apogee sign of the thermal expansion coefficient in the region compared to the pure GSM5 without hydrocarbons adsorbed, which is a similar result I showed in the first case of the GSM5 without kappa exchange case. So our work provides internal structural variation of kappa exchanged GSM5 crystal due to inhomogeneous distribution of kappa ion with different size and diffusion rate of the hydrocarbons by the strain evolution during their adsorption processes. Actually, next topic I like to show is the active site localization observed during the methane oxidation process, which is important in vehicle catalytic converter. So our platinum nanoparticles were grown by de-wetting method, and the activation temperature was about 700 K. So actually, the coherent X-ray diffraction pattern and imaging result in 3D video in the previous slide is this platinum nanocrystal, actually. So as you can see, to see the structural changes along the steps of the catalysis, we measured with a controlled gas environment. As you can see, we exposed 1% of hydrogen first to clean the surface of the platinum nanoparticles, and then evacuated all the hydrogen gases and inserted 20% of oxygen, and we measured the EXD patterns for oxygen adsorption. And then after the diffraction pattern doesn't change up to the diffraction pattern doesn't change, we removed all the excessive oxygens, and we entered the 1% of methane in the sample chamber. So, which means, sorry, we during the methane oxidation, we observed again the coherent X-ray diffraction pattern. So, in order to see whole changes during the catalytic process with different gas environment and exposure time, we applied Pearce correlation function to the total three-dimensional CXD patterns to understand how distortion evolved during the catalytic process. So the gas environment together with the exposure time are indicated on the X and Y axis. So experimental conditions are also indicated in the map with the black arrows shown here. So immediate distortion appeared after the oxygen was introduced, as you can see here. And then the original diffraction was recovered after like 22 minutes of the here, 22 minutes of the methane exposure, which means this reversion can be attributed to the available oxygen being consumed by catalytic oxidation. So, I mean, during this measurement, for the same procedure measurement, we actually carried out the gas analysis to check the catalytic reaction and resultant products as well. So briefly, the coherent X-ray diffraction pattern, even clearer pattern are shown here. So below activation temperature, we didn't see any changes independent of the gas composition. But at 700 K, which is above the activation temperature, we observed like a 20% of oxygen. Really, the diffraction pattern changes near the black peak, actually, which means looks like long range order changes appeared. And 1% of methane, even the severe changes of the distortion observed. And as I mentioned, in the end of the methane exposure, which means the after finishing the reaction process, the diffraction pattern becomes to the original. So it appeared again 1% of the hydrogen exposure. So by coherent X-ray diffraction imaging result is consistent with what I mentioned in the diffraction pattern itself. So in hydrogen and 20% of oxygen, actually it becomes very blue. And no, sorry, this is 600 K. So actually it becomes blue, but not really local changes, but just the entire thing becomes blue. And 1% of methane exposure, not much changed. And 1% of hydrogen or 600 K, the changes are relatively very small. But 700 K, consistent with our observation in the diffraction pattern, in with the 20% of oxygen exposure, one side becomes blue and the other side becomes yellow or red. So as you can see, the displacement in red means with respect to the direction of measurement, actually with respect to this direction, the blue means the opposite direction, just changed the displacement in opposite direction, but in red means the same, the displacement with the same direction. So which means actually blue in this this side and red in this side means actually overall the nanocrystals actually shrunk, right? And with 1% of methane, the displaced amount of the displacement becomes larger. And again, after the process finishes, 1% of hydrogen becomes more or less becomes to the original. So to elucidate the reaction mechanism of methane oxidation on platinum, large again, I like to show. Well, this was not really the video is not working, so I like to show just as it is. So to elucidate reaction mechanism of methane oxidation of platinum, large scale reactive molecular dynamics simulations were performed. So snapshots of the atomic displacement of platinum nanocrystals in hydrogen and in oxygen gases and in in the methane after the oxidation are also shown here. So in hydrogen gas, we observed limited interaction between the platinum and hydrogen consistent with the experimental observations. And in O2 gases, the effect of oxidation of the nanocrystal are shown at the edges and corner sides where platinum atoms are under coordinated. So the molecular oxygen are fizzy dissolved on the surface of the nanocrystal, but the chemically adsorbed oxygen atoms, oxygen molecules are appeared in the edge of the crystals or corner sides. So to simulate the methane oxidation in limited adsorbed oxygen environment, we removed an unadsorbed oxygen molecules, while the adsorbed molecules, oxygen molecules are bonded, and bonded oxygen atoms were retained. And then we introduced the methane molecules and ran additional isothermal isobaric dynamics. So in this figure, we observed the bonding of methane molecules to the dissociated oxygen atom at the edge and corner sides. So the strain evolution of the platinum nanoparticles are summarized during the oxygen adsorption and methane oxidation on the left-hand side here. And then experimental results are compared with the simulation result of the reactive molecular dynamics informed finite element analysis are shown on the right side. So as I mentioned, three-dimensional image are colored by local displacement field of the surface at particle cross sections are shown in the right hand side of each data. So as you can see, with respect to the measured direction, actually experimental data shows exactly same as what I described here in the left hand, the blue in this direction and red in other side, which means actually the crystal lattice shrunk in oxygen environment. And with the methane exposure, initially when the catalytic process starts, and actually the part showing blue becomes even more blue and red becomes more red. So, and then after the reaction finishes, it becomes the original displacement, which is exactly consistent with our the simulation result. And now, actually, we during the same experimental process, we observed really the heterogeneity of sample related to the defects were observed. So as you can see, same process by Rakhenkov with different conditions of the gas exposure, the main peak during the Rakhenkov actually decreases the intensity, and another peak appears. As you can see, the cross-section of the diffraction pattern are shown at A and B correspondingly here. So which means initially we didn't understand what is going on here. However, later on, this is the result, because during the oxygen exposure, when two peaks appeared, imaging was not available in the beginning without understanding what is going on. So now, later on, three-dimensional reconstruct image with network defect networks, actually, we were able to obtain. So during the oxygen process, we observed like defects near the surface with their volumes in purple. So the dislocations of the defects were identified from their displacement field vortices and indicated by purple arrow here. So the volume of the defects is expanded inside of the nanocrystal with oxygen exposure, and the size of the instantaneous defect reached the maximum with the methane exposure. So in this case, this apparent loss of the density arises from the high number of the dislocation cores or stacking faults that interrupt the break diffraction conditions in those regions of the crystals. So in fact, these parts are not disappeared. So in the imaging result, the missing part was related to the, because of the defect, the electron density, break electron density is not contributed to this break peak, but after the oxidation process finishes, it becomes back. So which means really that part with related to the defect or rotated. So it is not contributed to the break electron density. So the strains represented in the cross section of the particle in the previous slide, the change of the compressive shown in blue and tensile in red, strains are shown on the oxygen and methane flow here. So the initial tensile strain was enlarged with oxygen gas exposure, and considerable propagation with even W shape is shown here. So it is enlarged with through the connection of the strongly strained part. So as the oxygen exposure time increases, the 111 break density volume decreases. So and the buoys were observed inside of the crystal, as I mentioned in the previous slide. So the behavior continued when crystal was exposed to methane flow, and the recovery of density loss after the reaction finishes, as you can see here. So remarkably, the parts enlarged with the tensile and compressive correspond to the origin of defect networks we observed here. So In addition, in the analysis of strain field distribution inside of the crystal by calculating the normalized strain energy, strain field energy and amplitude volume at sub 700K here shown here. So below activation temperature, which is 600K, the independent of gas actually it shows same, but this normalized strain field energy and amplitude volume shows exactly what we expected. And then we compared with the elastic strain energy with the dislocation cost, which means the particle having defect and without having defect. So we calculated the strain field energy depending on the gas environment and with the exposure time compared with the dislocation cost we calculated. So which is very consistent with our theoretical calculation and experimental result. So which means in this case, the defect in the nanocrystal actually contribute the more strain field energy to exceed the dislocation cost. So that's how we can observe such behavior related to the heterogeneity. As a last topic, actually I'd like to show very recent result observed in heterogeneity in chiral nanoparticles. Which are particularly interested in their catalytic and optical and electrical electronic properties. So in this case, it is important to determine the three-dimensional distribution of exposed surfaces in terms of the exact indexing of the crystallographic planes and determining the corresponding strain distribution. So in this case, our chiral nanoparticles are mainly induced by the ligands and so our nanoparticle was actually, I can show the next page, but here the helical surface of helicoid 3 chiral nanoparticles. So in this case, as I mentioned, structural identification of hidden gaps in chiral nanoparticles are very important to determine and correlating crystallographic and elastic properties are important in understanding the growth mechanisms. So using the coherent X-ray diffraction scattering imaging, we actually can understand the full understanding of chiral optical property of the nanostructures, which means strain tuned optical chirality probably we can understand. So since time is close to the end, I like to just finish very briefly. So we measured the CDI pattern at 200 breakbeat from this 432 haloid 3 chiral nanoparticles. And owing to its very complicated and complex morphology and the direction of the surface facets, this result shows complex interference fringes in the multiple directions. And these directions were mainly distributed in the high Miller index region on the stereographic projections and calculated stereographic whole figure projection of the CXD pattern shown here. And this is the imaged result. And by taking absolute value of a complex electron density 3-dimensional morphology of 432 helicoid 3 is shown here. And actually this figure shows the spatial distribution of Miller indices resolving a complex geometry. And we determined all the crystallographic orientation of nanoparticle from the Q vector shown determined here and surface normal direction parallel to the lattice vector, which is determined from the fitting here based on the Terras step kink model, which maximized the Terras ratio, the surface. So the kink density also was calculated from the extracted Miller index and mapped on the 432 helicoid 3 morphology. So it was confirmed that the chiral kink sites were mainly exposed on the surfaces of concave gaps. So from this analysis, we can obtain important evidence for the understanding of synthetic mechanism during the growth. And we learned the chiral gap structure comprises symmetric preserved high Miller index surfaces. And also we convert the surface normal vectors into the stereographic projections. So the distribution of surface Miller indexes are shown on the right, depending on the orientations. So the surface area of each Miller index with a color scale is shown for overall distribution of Miller indices mapped in two dimensions, and surface Miller indices of the four gaps and three gaps and one gap was observed in 100 and 111, 111, three gaps, and one gap observed in 110 respectively. And we also analyzed strain field of the 432 helicoid 3 with regard to geometry and surface Miller indices. And the strain field was calculated using Q component of the displacement gradient and both tensile and compressive strain were observed on the observed here, and in the surface strain distributed the chiral gap facing 1.0, actually this is 1 bar perpendicular to Q, the area indicated here in this regime, actually the compressive strain was observed at the concave edge, whereas tensile strain was observed at the side facets. So for more detailed information, contour map of the Miller index is shown here. And the Miller index contour map of the gap with this region showed the deepest edge of consisting of the 0.01 bar here. 0.01 bar and 1.00 and high Miller indices connecting these two directions. Whereas side faces consisted of the high Miller indexes adjust 1.11 in this case. So this strain Miller index relationship was confirmed by plotting the strain at each Miller index on 1.01 bar stereographic projections are shown here. And the strain fields of the 1.00 and 1.01 actually shown here with depth dependence. So you can really see inside the strain patterns, strains are clearly can see, and this is like a diagonalized with the tensile and compressive strains are like shown in opposite side. Also, we measured the strain development during the growth. So actually, the emergence of the chirality and strain development was measured. Actually, also the generated by initial selective interaction of the chiral ligand and metal surface. So actually, this result contributes the correction of the refractive index related to the optical chirality. So our strain information gives the correction of the refractive index in optical chirality. So basically, our result shows the resultant sensitivity of the chiral molecular detection. I mean, we can improve the sensitivity of the chiral molecular detection of the nano photonics. So as a conclusion, by Bragg coherent X-ray diffraction imaging technique, I showed a few examples of the measuring local heterogeneity. So the first case, the heterogeneity originated from the organic residue during the synthetic process. And secondly, inhomogeneous distribution of the exchanged kappa ions in geolite during the NOx deoxygenation. And thirdly, same inhomogeneous distribution of exchanged ions in geolite during the hydrocarbon adsorption process. We also observed active site localization and defect dynamics of platinum nanoparticles during the methane oxidation related to the selective, the site adsorption and catalytic process and defect related to heterogeneity. And we also obtained a map of internal strain distribution of chiral gold nanoparticle, which gives corrections to optical refractive index for chiral molecular detection of the nanophotonics. I thank all the members in my group and department of the samples of geolite are mainly from the chemistry department of Seogang, and all the measurements are actually in collaboration with the advanced photon source in Argonne National Laboratory and Petra 3 in Deji and LCLC in US, I mean SLAC and Brookhaven National Laboratory and PRS2. I also acknowledge the funding agency, and all the current group members are shown here. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Yuning, for this overview on the research. It's quite an impressive number of results you show there. So now the session is open for questions. You can just write them in the chat, or you can raise your hand and I'll unmute yourself and ask questions immediately. I have one about the XPCS that you have shown. You've gone quickly through those results. I understand that there is a clear signature of sudden event, and it wasn't clear to me which time resolution you had there. So are you saying that during the various chemical processes there is either a full correlation? So the changes on structure are sudden, or did I misinterpret, or maybe the time resolution?
I'm not so sure which one, but
on then the on I, the platinum.
Okay, okay. One moment. Ah, you mean this one?
You stop sharing, so I don't know.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. Yes, this one.
Okay, this one.
Yeah.
The sudden changes, actually, this is a little bit misleading. Because to clarify the process, we actually used one gas at the time and with hydrogen. And then after a while, we exchanged the gas after removing all the gases and then enter the new one. So here, for example, So for example here, this zero starts, zero means actually the time inserting the oxygen. Mm-hmm. But it is clear starting oxygen shows, sudden change of the distortion, but with all the adsorbed the oxygen environment, when we put the methane molecules goes onto the oxygen, it did not show any the abrupt changes. It shows more continuous changes, but the severe distortion appeared. Is it clear?
I mean, yes, I understand that. Yes.